Lukaku. Gareth Bale.
Luis Suarez.
Zidane.
Alvaro Morata.
Beckham.
Angel Di Mariano.
Of course.
Right there, but not as high.
James Rodriguez, did I already say that?
Yeah, big. Suarez, we said that?
Suarez, yeah. Done. David Beckham.
Guys, Paul Pogba.
Paul Pogba, Agam, is yesterday's news. Actually, it's last season's news.
Sure, yeah.
This season, there is a brand new headline. Every world record, perhaps some of those collectively, have all been broken for one man. And his name is Neymar.
So not just broken, shattered, trampled on, destroyed.
When Agam says Paul Pogba, we can double that.
Yeah,
and absolutely. Then we still won't get to Neymar's
more
transfer
than double
fee.
That. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So the figure was, what was 105 million euros was Paul Pogba last year. This time around, 222 million euros is what was paid, and it's a deal is just about, you know, it's done.
And you've had heads of state congratulating. Well, the teams involved, you've had Messi, Suarez, Neymar, everyone talking about it, and Neymar especially, considering it was the worst kept secrets of this transfer window. The transfer saga is officially over. Neymar is joining PSG. Well, he'll be unveiled very soon as a player. We've gotten you this live to understand whether it was just all about that transfer record fee of 222 million euros, which is not just that. It goes on into a lot more with his salaries, endorsements. There's a lot more money involved, which Agam and Alex and I are going to talk about. But first, Neymar had to obviously vindicate himself and speak to his beloved Barcelona fans at the Blaugrana. And this is what he had to say in an emotional farewell on Instagram that he posted earlier today.
Preparei um textinho aqui pro dia de hoje. A vida de um atleta é movida por desafios. Alguns são impostos a nós, outros são fruto de uma decisão nossa. Para mantermos a luz que ilumina a nossa carreira, que é intensa, mas curta.
Neymar.
Barcelona foi mais do que um desafio. Foi um sonho de criança que jogava com aqueles craques no videogame. Cheguei na Catalunha com 21 anos, cheio de desafios. Até hoje lembro dos meus primeiros dias no clube, dividindo vestiário com ídolos como Messi, Valdez, Xavi, Iniesta, Puyol, Piqué, Busquets, entre outros. Na expectativa de atuar em um clube que é mais que um clube, o Barcelona é uma nação que representa a Catalunha. Tive a honra de atuar com o maior atleta que vi na vida e que tenho certeza que não verei outro enquanto eu viver. Léo Messi. Virou meu parceiro, amigo, dentro e fora de campo. Foi uma grande honra jogar com você. Foi um ataque com Messi e Suárez que fez história. Conquistei tudo que um atleta poderia conquistar. Vivi momentos inesquecíveis. Moro em uma cidade que é mais que uma cidade. É uma pátria, amo Barcelona e amo a Catalunha. Mas um atleta, no caso eu, precisa de desafios. Pela segunda vez na vida eu contrariei meu pai. Pai, entendo e respeito sua opinião. A minha decisão está tomada e espero que você me apoie como sempre fez.
Então, vai com Deus, seja feliz, tá bom, filho? Mas corra, tá? Beijo, estou correndo aqui em cima contigo.
O Barcelona e a Catalunha estarão sempre no meu coração, mas preciso de novos desafios. Aceitei a proposta do Paris para tentar novas conquistas e ajudar o clube a alcançar os títulos que sua torcida espera. Me apresentaram um plano de carreira muito ousado e me sinto pronto para esse desafio. Agradeço o carinho da maravilhosa torcida blaugrana e a tudo que aprendi com os grandes atletas com quem dividi o vestiário. Mas sinto em meu coração que é hora de partir. O Paris será minha casa nos próximos anos. E trabalharei para honrar toda a confiança depositada no meu futebol. Conto muito com o apoio de todos vocês, torcedores que estão comigo desde 2009. Dos meus amigos, dos profissionais que me acompanham e principalmente da minha família, que sofreu muito com alguns problemas que ocorreram neste período da minha carreira, que hoje merecem paz. É uma decisão muito difícil, mas foi tomada com maturidade que acumulei nos meus 25 anos. Barcelona, gracias por todos. Paris, j'arrive. Que Deus abençoe e nos proteja. Valeu.
Million euros is what we're talking about now. To me, it seems a little bit of an astronomical figure. And I think I don't know if it justifies, or the player justifies that kind of money. That's my personal opinion.
Yeah, sure.
But before we move on to that analysis, well, this was from his Facebook page, actually.
Yeah.
Which actually, I think, I'm not very good at French, guys, but I think this translates into, I'm here, right here in Paris. Well, obviously, the Eiffel Tower sort of sorts that out. Moving on, it actually, well, 222 million is what Alex was talking about. Alex, you think it's not justified?
I don't think it's justified.
Agam?
And this is just not it, right?
So, yeah, you got to consider the fact that he's going to be, well, I think one particular publication put it at €1 per second as long as he's a PSG player. And so
if you consider the 222 million plus, the salary that he's going to be paid over the next 5 years, that's what his contract is, his agent fees plus taxation, it all comes to around 400 to 450 million euros. Now, in 2016, England's top five clubs spent around 4 billion euros together. Neymar, only Neymar, it's one-tenth of that sum. That's as far as perspective goes.
Well, it's more than a few. Well, I don't know. What did Manchester City? What did Manchester City pay for his defense this time around?
Yes. So Manchester City this time around spent around $200 million, and that is more than the defense budgets of 47 countries in the world out there. That's $200 million, and Neymar, of course, at around 222 million euros.
But just to put things in context, Ayush, there are a lot of expensive players. There have been in the recent.
There have been, and we were sort of playing like a game of countries and name throwing out there, because those were some of the biggest deals in the last 20 years of global football. A lot of them have been from Premier League to La Liga. When I say La Liga, it's perhaps just Barcelona and Real Madrid. Now, with so much of Arab money coming in and foreign money coming into other leagues in Europe, well, there's been a lot of them now in France.
Yeah.
There's also been a lot of money in China. I think, Alex, but this one with his wages as well, the wages are also perhaps a record, or is that second to Tevez perhaps?
So, I don't know about the pre-tax, post-tax
considering Tevez being in China.
See how that plays out, but I think pre-tax, what he's earning is about 45 million euros a year.
Right.
That's 865,000 euros a week.
Right.
And probably that's the calculation that amounts to about a euro a second.
And when you say it's not worth it, right, Alex? Well, just think about it. There was actually a lovely piece on Forbes as well, which was on the Forbes list of the highest paid players, why Neymar is way more marketable even than Ronaldo. Right? You guys are saying Ronaldo is perhaps the most marketable guy. Well, he's much older. He's 7 years older than Neymar.
Right.
Right? And at that piece actually talks about, and this is an interesting one, he says at 24, Ronaldo, who's obviously 7 years Neymar senior, made $9 million, roughly $10 million according to the Forbes list. Well, Neymar currently makes $21 million from endorsements. This is endorsement money, at least. So even with adjusted for inflation, that's twice as much, but twice more than Ronaldo ever made at that age.
If you actually stop to consider, that's beyond endorsements, and apparently he earns more than Messi in endorsements. But if you actually look at some of the
purely transfer fees,
just purely transfer fees and the way it's moved, right? You had Luis Suarez move from Liverpool, unfortunately, to Barcelona for £75 million. You had Gareth Bale, which was for a long time the world record, at £85 million.
Yeah.
And then you had Paul Pogba just a little over that. This time around, Neymar, it's smashed.
So let's consider the basics, right?
Yeah.
He's a part of the MSN.
Yes.
All right.
Messi,
he's a Barcelona
Suarez,
player
Neymar.
Right now. He's 25 years old. And given you have guys like Suarez and Messi in your team, you still have about 105 goals over the four seasons. That's roughly 25 goals a season. That's not a bad average to have when you have guys like Suarez and Messi around.
Yeah.
And
he scored over 100 goals in four seasons.
Right. So no, he has pace.
But Agam, when you talk about MSN, it's very special, because when you have three players of that caliber in one team, be it national team, club aside, if you have that level of players playing together, well, there are egos involved. They don't always gel in. We remember Gerrard and Lampard could never play in a midfield together for England, right? It was a dream, perhaps, at Chelsea, which never realized, but they couldn't. Messi, Suarez and Neymar, and I saw them play a couple of months ago, play like family.
Right.
They're like brothers. So, and even the emotional farewells that Suarez gave, or even even Messi gave yesterday on Instagram, it just showed that they were all heartbroken. But the fact of the matter is, and if you go through, well, any of the sports commentators and what they've been saying, they've essentially been saying, Agam, that the reason he moved out is because, yet again, Barcelona made it very clear that while they wanted him, they really valued that trio of MSN. The fact of the matter is that Messi is priority number one for Barcelona.
Absolutely, yes.
So he'll never be able to replace Messi. But although Messi in the friendly did let him take that free kick, just as a statement of intent.
But if you actually think about it, and I think you have the exact quote.
Yeah.
I'm paraphrasing here, but he says his statement with regard to this transfer is that he wants a new challenge.
Which is what he says in the video as well.
He wants a new challenge when he's moving to Paris Saint-Germain. And he thinks that he's moving to one of the most ambitious clubs in Europe at this point.
Right.
I'm not sure if I want to believe him on that one.
That's what he's saying.
No, right? But just to give you that brotherly love, well, on Wednesday, Messi posted on Instagram, and this is the translation in English. It was a great pleasure to have shared all these years with you, my friend Neymar. I wish you good luck in this new stage of your life. To which Neymar, from his official account, the one that we are playing the video from, says, thank you, brother. I will miss you.
Yeah.
So it's a big setback for Barcelona as well, but there's a lot of money that's coming. Right. Really, they're going to be utilizing it for some top players now. Hopefully not from Anfield or from Liverpool.
Having said that, there are a couple of people. So a lot of people have been weighing in on this entire conversation with Neymar. In fact, Jose Mourinho
said he's not expensive at all.
He said it's not expensive. He said that Neymar, considering the quality of player that he is valued appropriately. However, it's going to change the other transfers that occur after that. Even for Barcelona, if you actually think about it, considering the kind of targets that they have, Kylian Mbappe, Coutinho. Now, look, Liverpool and Monaco at this point know for a fact that Barcelona has at least 222 million euros.
So they're
going to
play hardball with
them
for sure.
They're definitely going to up the ante with regard to the prices that they demand.
But you know, Alex, you were talking about those transfer fees and purely transfer fees. It's interesting because, let's be honest, when Kevin De Bruyne actually moved to Chelsea and he moved back to Manchester City, to the Premier League, well, people laughed at Chelsea for letting him go, right? Morata with Real Madrid, it was the same thing, right? A youth product. Di Maria is coming and going from the Premier League. Maybe it didn't work out. Questions weren't raised for any of these figures, right? Questions, well, considering it's an inflated market, Lukaku as well. Higuain, a few questions were raised.
Saying,
is he worth that much money, really?
Yes.
Or is it just a lot of money out there in the market and hence more figures?
No, that was a question. That was certainly a questionable number out there.
Ronaldo, no one, you know, had the gall to question Ronaldo because Ronaldo's
really.
Ronaldo. And well, he's been, for the past so many years, he's been the most marketable figure in world sport for businesses and brands as well. Gareth Bale, a lot of questions were asking, how can Gareth Bale, this Welshman, top Ronaldo? Paul Pogba was perhaps the most questionable figure, saying this guy who couldn't make it in England, where he's back.
Well, you know what? Honestly, I think Paul Pogba, there was a lot riding on the back of Paul Pogba, and he hasn't come through on the expectations. Paul Pogba, in hindsight, doesn't look that good.
All of these figures pale in comparison to this. Like, this
absolutely,
is certainly
yes.
benchmark.
Yes.
Euros.
Yes.
Like,
yes.
you know, think about it.
So, hold on. There's one comment coming in. Abhishek Sharma, if you're watching currently, I just saw your comment. We're not experts, we're discussing this news break. We're all journalists and researchers in Agam's case. And we invite you, in fact, to participate in this discussion. The debate that we're having and what we started talking about is that, is this all about the money or is there something more than that?
And actually coming to that particular debate, well, we got a message coming in saying, who owns PSG? And that should be the next point of our conversation. Well, that's the best question. Sure. I'll tell you who actually raised it. It's Mrugank Burgulkar. Mrugank Burgulkar says, who owns PSG? Agam, Alex, who owns PSG?
Well, we don't
because
know.
It's something the
it's certainly not Qatar. I mean, it's certainly not all of it is from. But,
so,
well,
so the group's actually, I think, Oryx Qatar Sports Investments, which well
has ties to the Qatar royal family.
Which is essentially so the debate in Spain and the La Liga has been, and even the La Liga's senior personnel have said that this is not owned by one particular person. It's owned by a state. Saying that because there's a big, big political message behind this move, and we have Bloomberg pieces, Agam, you know, which have actually come out, which back that up, saying this is perhaps the biggest PR coup for a country but that has not only been cut off by the Saudi-led alliance, but is also hosting a World Cup in 2022 where several questions were raised.
But that's the context, and it's important to point that out. What essentially happened in June, Agam, is the fact that the Saudi Arabia-led bloc of about five countries cut off all ties, transport, trade, because the allegations that were made was that Qatar was sponsoring extremist groups.
Absolutely.
And the closeness that was perceived with Iran.
Which is something Qatar, well, categorically denies.
Yes, and has been campaigning, like you said, globally for some time. This is being viewed, and I want to read this quote because I loved it. I pointed it out. I said, we must talk about this. This is a quote coming in from Simon Chadwick, who is a professor of sports enterprise at the University of Salford in the UK. This is from a Bloomberg piece that was written. Qatar has not capitulated. It is fighting back, and the Neymar signing is part of that. He goes on to say, it's a charm offensive, a soft power stance. There's something of international diplomacy in all of this. The last thing Saudi Arabia wants is people all over the world talking about Qatar. So there you have it. It's being viewed not just as a move in football, as PSG signing the most expensive player in the world. It's also being viewed as Qatar making a statement in the geopolitical landscape of the Middle East.
This is Rahil Qureshi. Thanks so much for writing in. Rahil, Agam, Alex asks a very pertinent question. He says that my question is that this total money directly goes to Neymar or in sharing with the club. This is because a lot of us in India here support IPL teams as well. It works very differently.
Right.
So let's break down the numbers for Rahil and everyone else watching.
Absolutely, yeah.
Essentially, it's going to be Rahil, 222 million euros was the trigger. It was the buyout clause in Neymar's Barcelona contract. Anyone, any bidder who could match that, Barcelona would be in talks with them to sell. After that, it obviously depends on the player agreeing personal terms with that club. Right, so that's when the agents and lawyers come in. And here there was a lot more than agents and lawyers. Obviously, you know, you had the French president, Macron, also, you know, acknowledging something big, some good news coming in from this particular investment.
Right.
And then there's all those whopping sums that Agam came up with, right? So with his, so the salary component, I would imagine, would go entirely to Neymar. And that comes from PSG as a player earns that salary or wages.
Right.
The transfer amount goes entirely to Barcelona. There would be some, perhaps, I don't know, there's a clause with Santos when Neymar moved many years ago, because when a player moves from before, sometimes from a feeder club, there are some percentage cuts involved. That might be another one. And well, then the endorsement deals are obviously him on his own. That is the brand of Neymar bringing endorsements to the city, to the country, to the club as well.
And Neymar Senior also makes some money because, well, he is Neymar's agent, so.
Yeah, and agents always make a cut.
So it's all in the family.
So a lot of people watching at this point, but see, what we want to achieve through this is we want to ask you to comment and participate in this discussion. What do you think? Do you think over 200 million euro for a footballer is justifiable at this stage? Do you think it's too much money to be spent?
Right.
What do you think will happen to the rest of the transfer market at this point? Do you think the clubs that you support will have to shell out much more than they did over the past couple of seasons? That's probably a given at this stage, considering the deals that have already happened, apart from the...
So you wanted them to win on the conversation, and that's exactly what they're doing on Facebook. Mrugang actually writes in saying, the transfer seems more like a marketing statement by Qatar against the apparent questionable economy. Right. So there are people obviously wondering, saying, what's the whole deal? But clearly, the first question we asked is it all about the money? It's not all about the money, because there's a lot more involved. It's a big statement of intent from Qatar to the Saudi-led alliance and to the world at large that we can invest this much money. And well, of course, there is liquidity and we can spend on a player like that.
Right.
And this is all in context of the World Cup coming up.
Yes.
They have to establish that they are capable and they're very serious about football.
What were the top three or four questions raised when Qatar won the bid? Apart from the weather, let's talk about pure financials and football. Well, the first question that was raised was, will a country the size of perhaps the state of Connecticut be able to host the biggest sporting event perhaps on planet Earth? That was one. Two, is there a culture for something like this? Will that culture be open to a World Cup like this? That was the second question. With the weather, let's include the weather with the culture then. And the third question that was actually was human rights questions, right? About how the workers who are building these tons of stadiums all over Qatar will manage to do it. Then with this particular diplomatic problem that they face now, where all the questions came, because a lot of the feeder states for their raw materials, for their architecture, the infrastructure, a lot of those states cut ties with them.
Right.
So they've actually had to spend a lot more money to procure all of that and get it done. Also, let's remember, Qatar doesn't have much of a sporting history when it comes to football.
And absolutely, yes.
So it's quite a bloomer of a state right now. But so these are the questions. So this seems like a big statement of intent, guys, when
but
it comes to...
Having said that, they've been doing a lot of things. This
absolutely.
Is one,
absolutely.
This is one definitely one element of it. But apparently they've had a lot of international players come in to Qatar and speak about the fact that they're
that's
comfortable
true.
Playing there.
That's
there's one famous former Barcelona player,
Xavi,
that's playing in a club in Qatar.
And that video by Xavi went viral, where he actually told the world community, international community at large, to stop boycotting Qatar. I think he plays for Al Sadd, one of those clubs in Qatar, one of the greatest midfielders of all time. But there's also a Bloomberg piece, which you guys should go on our website on bloombergquin.com, and I'll put a link up there for you, saying the transfer is the latest in a series of headline-grabbing deals by Qatar. If you want to know more about Qatar, this is it. Well, all of the accusations aside, the world's top exporter of liquefied natural gas has since agreed to buy F-15 fighter jets from the US, 7 warships from Italy, and flirted with the idea of buying a stake in American Airlines. Remember, there's also that talk about them investing in a domestic carrier here in India, right?
Yes.
So
hmm.
they've been all over the place trying to settle the situation. It's kind of interesting, right? How one Brazilian 25-year-old superstar
right.
of a footballer can manage to salvage so much PR for you and perhaps make a big statement when it comes to soft power.
But the importance is that people all over the world are talking about it.
Yeah.
You have, well, Bloomberg is a publication or rather in the United States, and when you're talking about everybody in the United States, huge investors are going to be aware of this. The fact that €220 million has been spent on one player, and a lot more over the next 3 or 4 years. But beyond that, Ayush, do you think so? Now we've established the fact that Qatar stands to gain with regard to this particular move. If you're talking about the actual move, do you think the French league will change on account of this? Do you think PSG is
really
going to take it to the next level?
Well, no. Okay. In my opinion, it's not a great league. It's not a very competitive league. Sure, you will have one or two teams like Monaco and PSG out there, but they really haven't done too much with respect to the Champions League. And well, if you are in PSG, it's easy to win. It's certainly not as competitive as the English or the Spanish or even the German league.
Are they going to compete more aggressively in the UEFA Champions League?
Right, no, I'm so sorry, I'm just engrossed in all the comments. There's stuff coming on Periscope and on Facebook Live.
But the Champions League, do you think they stand...
Let's be honest here, I mean, if, you know, with Verratti and whatever's been happening with Verratti, they do have a squad, so perhaps they can do stuff in the Champions League. They were there last season. In fact...
they haven't yet won.
Neymar's performance against PSG might have been the cementing factor, considering what he did.
Sure.
That pass was just perhaps the most delectable pass that I've seen in the past couple of years. So the same thing happened, right? The Champions League actually is a very interesting competition where a lot of these top players who perhaps want a move or are angling at a move, if they perform, is when they're courted. Gareth Bale did it as well, right?
Right.
When he actually did so well in the Champions League.
So I couldn't help but notice that PSG now is essentially comprised of good French players and good Brazilian players.
Right.
They have good 3 or 4 Brazilian players and another 3 or 4 coming from France. And we know how these nations have been developing. We've seen them perform in, you know, the country championships. And well, we just had to wait and watch. But again, PSG has very little competition in the league itself, which makes development tough. Sure, they're in Champions League, but they really haven't done too much in Champions League over the last few seasons either.
And the Champions League, obviously, clearly, let's get back to how much it means. A lot of money. It means a lot more viewership. It means all those things for these clubs.
Yeah.
And if Neymar is obviously playing, you're going to essentially say, well, that's what one big English businessman once put. He puts backsides on seats because that's what he can do. You know, I mean, he's the kind of guy who can get people to come and watch. It's more, you know, a match becomes more like a tourist attraction because
sure.
it's Neymar playing. And Neymar's perhaps, you know, his career is going to span a lot more than even Ronaldo's, clearly, most likely, and Messi's. And this is also an opportunity for Neymar to carve a niche for himself.
Yes.
Right? So I think these are the key ones. We'll have to get back on exactly later today. Perhaps we'll have some clarity in terms of what his wages will be like, how much tax gets deducted, considering, well, you know, Zlatan and everyone were never happy when they were in Paris, considering how much the French actually cut in terms of tax. Yeah. But I think it's massive. It's big news. All those names that Agam, Alex and I took.
No, and it's certainly a statement of intent, as you said. It's going to pull more players in. And, well, in that case, if that changes the constitution of the team, then it becomes very important.
So, who knows? Kylian Mbappe is very, very recently, I don't know what the number was, but at that point of time, he was being valued as the most expensive.
At 100 million is what they had said. That was a report. 100 million pounds is what I read last. And also, remember, he plays in Monaco, right?
And he's what? He's a
18 or 19 years old. Well, and Monaco did beat PSG at the end of the day. Yeah. So this is a big deal for PSG, I think. It's a big deal for, well, the French. It's a big deal for, I think, all of them. I think when Pogba actually moved to Manchester United, well, you know, he never moved to PSG.
Right.
You've managed to get someone from Brazil who was plying his trade with perhaps the greatest footballers of all time at Barcelona to France. Well, and Agam is right. The rest of the league isn't as competitive as any of these leagues, and that we know. It's nothing like the English Premier League. It's nothing like the La Liga. It's perhaps not even as competitive as the Bundesliga. Right. But yes, I think he has an opportunity to perform in the Champions League.
Having said that, I'm excited about what's going to happen in the remainder of this transfer season, particularly for the club that I support. I want to see who goes out, if someone does go out, I hope not, and who we indeed, or rather Liverpool, let me not say we, Liverpool ends up buying, and I'm sure you guys are, and you guys who are watching, are very keen to find out as well.
Well, absolutely, and well, we're all Liverpool fans. We're soon going to gather around very soon and talk about transfer deadline day. You've got to stay tuned to Bloomberg Print for that. But for now, the world record transfer fee has been smashed, has been obliterated for this one man, Neymar Jr. Well, and you're watching Bloomberg Quinn. Thank you so much for joining us.